This is Anguilla anguilla, otherwise known as the European eel. While it might look like one of the least exciting species to have ever flopped its way out of a biology textbook, its bizarre life cycle and apparent lack of reproductive paraphernalia have been baffling scientists for at least the last 2,000 years. In his book Historia Animalium, Aristotle writes that eels come into being spontaneously. They are born out of the Earth's guts and grow in the mud. Later, Freud's fruitless search for the male eel genitalia drove him off the natural sciences completely, and may have had something to do with some of his more bizarre theories of psychoanalysis. But eels aren't some sort of magic creature coming into being from drops of dew or horsetail hairs. The truth is even stranger. Our story begins far out in the ocean, in a place known as the Sargasso Sea. It's bordered not by continents, but by mighty ocean currents. Freshly hatched eel larvae, known as leptocephali, look like small transparent willow leaves just a couple of millimeters across. Without proper mouths or digestive systems, they absorb nutrients directly through their skin. Living up to a kilometer down in the nocturnal forests of the night, they get these mostly through marine snow, a mix of fish poop and dead phytoplankton raining in from above. Living on this diet, it takes them 2 to 3 years to grow strong enough to break out of the nursery and use their leaf-like shape to ride the North Atlantic current to the coasts of Europe. 40 million years ago, when the species first evolved, the Sargasso Sea and mainland Europe were much closer together. However, time and tectonic activity have since torn them apart, and today that trip is some 6,500 kilometers. When they eventually reach the slightly warmer, slightly less salty coasts, this triggers the eel's first metamorphosis. It reabsorbs its gelatinous outer tissue, and it becomes what we call glass eels. A saltwater fish moving into a freshwater body would have its cells swell up and explode as osmotic water pressure forces water in. To prevent that from happening, the eel undergoes another metamorphosis, becoming elvers. These have more robust internal organs, able to better regulate salt levels. In the spring, under the light of the full moon, thousands of elvers will gather together and have a mass migration upstream, pushing apart obstacles and overwhelming predators that might want to eat them. They go up rivers, lakes, streams, and even climb up onto land should the need arise. Eventually, in some calm river or cozy pond, they find a place to call home. After this mammoth journey, the eel takes a well-deserved break. They undergo another metamorphosis into what we know as the yellow eel. They're colored this way in order to better blend in with their muddy environment. They're solitary creatures, traveling just a couple hundred meters in search of food. Fish, worms, bugs, small mammals, and anything else they can get their jaws on. If prevented from this life of gluttony, it appears that they're able to put time on pause. In Sweden, there's legend of the Brackavik eel. It was caught by an 8-year-old and dumped down a well. There it remained in the cold and in the dark, outliving the boy, his kids, and his kids' kids. 150 years later, a film crew dredged it up, found it to be small, pale, and with enormous eyes, adapted for the void that was its universe. However, it was still very much just an adolescent yellow eel. If allowed to feast without being distracted by the cosmic horror that is an 8-year-old with a bucket, then it takes 20 to 30 years for the eel to put on enough fat to undergo one final metamorphosis into the silver eel. They put on muscle and use it to clamber back down the waterways of Europe and into the sea. Here they'll swim hundreds of meters beneath the surface, where there are less predators to get them. They'll also be silver in color because this allows them to better blend in with the marine landscape. They're in no hurry, taking 6 months to 18 to make it to their spawning grounds. During this trip, they won't eat, reabsorbing their internal organs, particularly their digestive system, which they don't need, and replacing it with reproductive ones, eventually reaching full maturity just as they reach the Sargasso Sea. Here, thousands of eels will come together in an enormous spawning event, reproducing just once and then dying, their bodies sinking back down into the deep. With all this in mind, we can put together some of the pieces as to why eels were so confusing for early scientists. They have 5 distinct life stages which look nothing alike, moving only from one to the next under very specific circumstances. Elvers have a habit of clambering up onto land, appearing in ponds where previously there were no eel. Most confusingly, only the silver eel has any sort of reproductive organs, and even then, only when they're far out to sea, beyond the prying eyes of scientists. It's no wonder we thought they just appeared out of nowhere. Of course, the eel is just a regular fish, even if it does have a pretty bizarre life cycle. It was only a matter of time before we could find some of the missing pieces. A big help for this was the fact that Europeans love eating high-calorie fatty eel, and have been doing so since at least the Middle Ages. You can cook it into a variety of more or less appealing dishes, meaning that fishermen are always catching it. In 1777, they found a female eel with female reproductive organs, and a little over 100 years later, we found a male with male reproductive organs, finally proving that eels do indeed do it. In 1886, a French zoologist studying leptocephali let the water in his tank get a temperature that was a little bit too high, and a salt concentration that was a little bit too low. The larvae correctly deducing that they'd reached mainland Europe and metamorphosizing into the glass eel. This let us realize that eels undergo metamorphosis, eventually letting us link what we thought were five separate species into just different parts of one animal's life cycle. With this improved understanding, Danish biologist Johannes Schmidt came up with a rather ingenious method of working out where eels reproduce. Rather than following the adults, instead he'd look for their spawn, realizing that the smaller the leptocephali were, then the closer they'd be to their original spawning ground. Starting in 1904, he spent 20 years, first in the Mediterranean and then the Atlantic, always moving in the direction of smaller and smaller ones, eventually drawing a circle on a map around today what we know as the Sargasso Sea. It took modern science decades and thousands of tagged eels in order to confirm this hypothesis. Tagging eels is difficult. They have a habit of being eaten by predators, and if they swim too deep, then the electronics fail. However, eventually we were able to track some of the eels from mainland Europe to the Azores, and from the Azores release new eels, following one, just one, all the way to the Sargasso Sea. The Sargasso is a really inconvenient place to be doing science. For one thing, it's enormous, about the size of the United States. It's also deep, 7 kilometers in places. It's also what we call a marine desert. This means that there's very little life there, and since there's nothing for the fishermen to catch, fishermen don't go there, so we can't rely on them helping out with some of the sampling. In old fishermen's tales, it was a place to be feared. Ships there would grow becalmed, crews dying of lack of fresh water and food. It was a place of the Bermuda Triangle and of ghost ships. Today, it's where you'll find the Great Atlantic Garbage Patch. After 2,000 years of scientific problem solving, we have a better understanding of the eel's reproductive life cycle. However, we're still to find any adult eels in the Sargasso Sea. We haven't observed them spawning, and we haven't found any eggs. We've observed similar eels in similar seas, and have been able to observe the process in captivity. But at least for the European eel, and at least for now, the truth behind its reproduction remains one of science's last great mysteries. Maybe the eel just wants to be left alone. This has been James Dingley from the Atomic Frontier. Keep looking up. Hello there.